Hello and welcome back to California Geology. I am Dr. Robert Lopez. Today I want to talk about volcanoes. The California Geological Survey notes that an active volcano is one that erupted in the past 2,000 years, and a potentially active volcano is one that erupted in the past 1.6 million years. And according to that criteria, there are about 20 active vents in California and about 500 potentially active volcanic vents in the state. And two of the most active areas are the Cascade region up here, both the Cascade Range, including Lassen Peak and Mount Shasta, and as well as the Modoc Plateau over here to the east, which includes the Medicine Lake volcano. On the Eastern Sierra, the Long Valley Caldera, Mono Lake area, the Mono Craters, are again another region of seismic activity due to magma beneath the surface. And then a couple of other regions down out here in Southern California, but really the two that I want you to focus on are the Shasta-Modoc Plateau and then this Eastern Sierra Basin and Range province here. Now, when we look at volcanic rocks, really what determines how explosive a volcano will be and the shape of the volcano will be the lava chemistry, you know, how viscous the lava will be. For example, if it's higher in silica, up here around 68% to 77%, then the lava tends to be very viscous and sticky. And so that makes kind of a lumpy lava, high resistance to flow, thick and sticky. The lava doesn't have very much mobility. And as you go towards the less felsic and more mafic end, like basalt, note that here it's more runny. It's a thinner lava and it flows farther from the volcanic vent. So this basalt lava tends to make a broad, flat volcano, whereas the more felsic magma tends to make more peak-shaped volcanoes. Now, when we look at volcanic rocks, I always define a volcano as a hill or a mound produced by eruption. And you're either going to eject material into the air, which is called tephra, or lava will pour into the ground. Now, what controls this viscosity? And it's really this silica tetrahedron. And you'll find that when I talked about minerals, I talked about the tetrahedron and its structural shape. And what it is here, I've drawn it in two-dimensional form. And when there's more silica, you get more of this polymerization. And what that means, a polymer is sort of like a fabric where the molecules tend to stick together or clump together. So the more silica, more polymerization, linking together the tetrahedra and makes the lava sticky and viscous. So felsic lava, which tends to have more silica, will be more sticky and viscous, right? Traps the gas at depth. So in other words, in the volcano at depth, the gas really can't escape because it's trapped in this polymerization structure. Finally, it'll escape when the volcano erupts, when it explodes all that gas. So this leads to an explosive eruption. On the other hand, if we have magnesium and iron, so magnesium and iron tend to break these chains of tetrahedra, and so magnesium and iron break the chains, so the gas can escape more easily from depth before the eruption, and so mafic volcanoes like the Hawaiian volcanoes, a lot of gas is coming out of the volcanoes, and so when those lavas erupt, in fact, most people pay. You can pay to go and ride a helicopter and look at this eruption from a helicopter. You wouldn't do that if it were a more felsic volcano. Now, iron and magnesium tend to break up these chains, and so when the eruption happens, it's less explosive, makes the lava more runny, tends to make these broader volcanoes. Now, when we look at the textures of volcanic rocks, well, we've talked about aphanitic and porphyritic textures, and we've looked at glassy and obsidian. What I want to look at is this vesicular basalt, and then this pyroclastic texture. So a good example of a vesicular texture is this rock here. So you can see the vesicles. This is a basalt lava with a good olivine crystals in there. And those little holes are where volcanic gases used to exist. If the lava is so full of vesicles, like this one here, we call this one a scoria. A scoria is a vesicular basalt so full of bubbles that it's called this case of scoria. And then for a more felsic rock would be the pumice. And pumice, in fact, here I have some water. One thing about pumice is so full of air bubbles that when you put it in water, it should float. And there it is. Here's a pumice floating in water. So here's a frothy volcanic glass right there, pumice. Now, the next thing I want to look at are the size ratings for pyroclastic rock, rock that erupts, explodes out of the volcano. Ash is less than 2 millimeters. Lapilli goes from 2 to 64 millimeters. And there's things called blocks and bombs are greater than 64 millimeters. 64 millimeters is about 3 inches, right? And so most pyroclastic rock is called a tuff. So volcanic tephra, pyroclastic rock composed mostly of ash. Over here, I do have a pyroclastic ash, tuff. In fact, this rock here has quite a bit of finer ash back in here. It's very ashy. And then it has these little blocks of pumice, which are lapilli size. So a common name for a pyroclastic rock like this would be a lapilli ash tuff. Lapilli ash tuff. And if you look carefully, you'll probably see some minerals in here of quartz. There's a nice little quartz crystal in there. I see a couple other ones back up in there. But again, this would be a felsic pyroclastic volcanic rock, the Bishop tuff. Now, when we look at blocks and bombs, well, here is a volcanic bomb. When a bomb comes out of the volcano, it comes out of the kind of a soft piece of magma that is kind of squishy, and it, as it's flying through the air, it becomes aerodynamic like this, almost like a football shape, and then hardens as it's flying through the air. So here's a classic volcanic bomb. You can see it's sort of like a flying saucer, kind of a tapered shape. Whereas a block, so this would be a bomb, a juvenile piece of magma. A block would be a piece of wall rock, pre-existing rock that erupted out of the volcano, something that's already hardened. Now, another thing I want to mention here is this kind of eruption cycles that happen. Usually we call these Plinian eruptions. And a couple of things I want you to note is that when the volcano erupts from these more felsic magmas, these more explosive magmas, the first thing you'll see this eruption column. This eruption column can go up to about 9 to 10 kilometers up into the air. 30,000 feet, this eruption column. And then the prevailing winds will pick up the ash and make an ash cloud. Some of this ash cloud may rain down onto the ground in a well-sorted ash fall tuff. Right? One thing about this is going to be well-sorted because the wind has sort of winnowed the different size fragments. So here they're all about the same size, well-sorted fallout tuff. Now, remember we have this eruption column way up here. At some point when the gases start running out or waning in the volcano, the column will collapse. And this collapse of a column will lead to this very dangerous pyroclastic flows. And the pyroclastic flows can travel over 100 kilometers per hour. In fact, your book says they go up to 100 miles per hour, so quite fast. But when they're coming, they're like avalanches, and they're very poorly sorted. Here I'm trying to draw the shapes of these in very different sizes. In fact, the Bishop Tuff I just showed you is an example of a pyroclastic ash flow. Again, very poorly sorted. Very dangerous, these pyroclastic ash flows. And then the fallout tuff would be underneath it. So eruption column, the ash cloud, the fallout tuff, and then these avalanches that occur from the eruption column collapsing into these pyroclastic ash flow tuffs.